PCB form factor requirements are getting smaller and smaller, which means we're designing our layouts with traces closer and closer together. But if we put them too close, they could interfere with each other, causing the receiver to get incorrect information. On this episode, we will be walking through how the effects of crosstalk can help you make important design and redesign decisions. Hi, I'm Melissa, and welcome to Scopes University. If you have traces too close together, they can interfere with each other. Serial data can disrupt power lines can disrupt serial lines, and serial lines can interfere with each other. Think of a self-driving vehicle. What if a serial packet was sent that was meant to turn a vehicle left by 90 degrees? But because of interference from another trace, the receiver saw this. And what if this packet means to turn the car right by 90 degrees? Obviously, some protocols have more strict margins than others, but you get my point. We want to send accurate signals. When signals on a board interfere with each other, we call this crosstalk. Luckily, you don't have to wait for your components to malfunction or your self-driving prototype to drive itself into a lake to find out if you have an issue. I'm going to show you how you can use Keysight's crosstalk application to find crosstalk and model how much better your designs could be without it. The Crosstalk app can analyze up to 4 signals at once, so if you have multiple traces close together, you can test them all. On my board, I have 3 serial data lines that are very close together, and I think the trace in the middle is at risk with interference from the traces on either side of it. My middle trace is the victim signal, and the ones on the outside are called the aggressor signals. I've connected the victim to channel 1 and the aggressors to channels 2 and 3. First, I'll create an eye diagram to see what my margins look like and find out if there is really a problem. I've centered my waveforms on screen and vertically scaled them. So now I'll go to Analyze, choose Quick Eye Diagrams, and Channel 1. This shows me what the eye diagram is of the victim signal. You can see the eye opening is very small, which means I do have errors and could be sending false packets, potentially sending my drone right into my coworker instead of up into the sky. But redesigning and building a new PCB board can be extensive, a lot of hard work, and very expensive. So to find out if it is worth it to go through all of that, I can have my crosstalk application quantify the amount of crosstalk on my victim, then remove it so I can view how my signal would look if I had a better layout. To set up my crosstalk application, I'll go to the Analyze menu and choose Crosstalk. I want my channel 1 signal to be set up as the victim, and I'll have the scope automatically configure my thresholds and clock recovery. I'm going to set channel 2 as an aggressor signal. It's serial data, and again, I'm going to have the scope auto-configure that. And channel 3 is also an aggressor, so I'll just go through the same steps. Now, going back to signal 1, I'm going to remove crosstalk from signal 2, signal 3, and any unknown crosstalk or noise that could be occurring. Now, I'll just enable this application and let the tool run. This red trace is now signal 1, the victim signal, with all of the crosstalk from channels 2 and 3 and any unknown crosstalk removed. And already we can see improvement. I'll create an eye diagram of this function to find out just how much it can be improved. To create an eye diagram on a function, I'll go back to my Analyze menu and I'll choose Gallery. And I'll scroll down to this real-time eye. And here's my function, crosstalk 1, and I'll turn on the eye diagram for that. Now you can see just how much more open the eye actually is compared to our original signal as is. To quantify how much more open the eye is, I can add some measurements. So we'll go to the measurement menu, add measurements, and over here I'm going to choose eye. And then we'll add eye height and eye width. Down here are my measurements. So my eye width is 74 picoseconds and my eye height is only 27.7 millivolts. Let's see how that compares to the signal with crosstalk removed. So I'll go to measure, add measurement, and we'll add eye height First, I have to choose my source, so we'll do this on crosstalk 1. We'll apply eye height and we'll apply eye width. So if I redesign my board to improve the layout and get rid of the crosstalk, my eye width could potentially be 125 picoseconds compared to the 88 picoseconds we have now. Additionally, the eye height is 109 millivolts, whereas the eye height as it is in this design is only 13 millivolts. After seeing how much better my eye diagram is with the crosstalk removed, I think in this case it might be worth it for me to redo my layout and find a better route for these traces. And I can use these measurements to justify the extra budget I need for a redesign. If you think this analysis tool would be useful to you, I encourage you to check out the link in the description below. And this episode concludes the first season of Scopes University.
Thanks to everyone who tuned in and watched. If you're excited about the next season of Scopes University, or if you have any questions we can address in future videos, please comment below.
Until then, I hope you've learned a lot here at Scopes U, and we'll see you next season.